So the first talk is entitled Leading Lives That Matter, Living Well, Live Well, Do Well, Age Well. And this will be given by the Vice President of Wake Forest University for University Advancement, Mark Peterson, and Dr. John Cooper, who is Chair of the College of Board of Visitors at Wake Forest University.
Well, thank you. Appreciate that, Danny. Good afternoon. My name is Mark Peterson, and as Danny said, I'm the Vice President for University Advancement. We're in our office, we spend all of our days engaging our alumni in the life of the university. The connection between Wake Forest and our alumni provides a mutually beneficial and deeply meaningful, long-standing relationship. What we know and what we are coming to understand is that that very well may enrich the lives of the university and the lives of our alumni at a much deeper level than we ever truly came to understand. So what our aim today is to talk a little bit about what that connection looks like and why it matters. So in order to do that, we wanted to share with you how we can live well, do well, and age well. For the past 5 years, my team's activities have centered around this campaign called Wake Will, the university's first ever national comprehensive capital campaign. Central to the campaign has been Dr. Nathan Hatch's vision of leading lives that matter as our core purpose as a university. The purpose of Wake Forest education, therefore, is not just about providing students with the skills and personal development for their initial careers, but about being able to make a difference in the communities in which they live and work. And ultimately, to live in the spirit of our motto, Pro Humanitate. The concept of leading lives that matter suggests that a binding element for all stages of life development, with special implications for alumni making a transition from their work life to their retired lives. And if, in fact, we live well and do well, can we age well too? What I know is that Wake Will has allowed us the opportunity to traverse the country meeting and speaking with alumni of all ages. In fact, I've traveled over 15,000 miles with Wake Will, which is actually halfway around the world if you're keeping score. And along the way, I've had the privilege of hearing the individual stories about how alumni have dedicated their lives to their communities and how that has enriched their life going forward. I get to bear witness to all the ways in which their lives matter. So here is how we've brought this idea, this notion of Wake Forest's intentional purpose of leading lives that matter to our communities. I'm going to share with you a little video we share with them. Oop. Potentially. Thanks, guys. Organizing our campaign around the idea that every life matters and that Wake Forest provides that great connection to meaning, we've begun to tap into a whole different strain of how it is that this university and its alumni can grow together. To explain the science behind that, I've invited Dr. John Cooper. John.
So, thanks. So, I am an engaged alumnus. And I applaud, from that perspective, all the great efforts of this conference. It shows how important adapting our culture to a rapidly aging population is and will be for us in the near future. And it does endorse that research is probably our most potent tool, and we've heard that today, in the quest to help more people live lives with purpose and meaning beyond their careers. Especially important to me because I'm going to retire this year, but one of the things I expect to do is to continue to be part of this group. There is a large group of individuals involved with Wake Forest. I'm fortunate and honored to be chair of one of the advisory groups, which is the Board of Visitors to the College. That's 60 true believers who support and advise the Dean of the College, Michelle Gillespie. But you can see we also have alumni around the country involved in Wake communities, as well as more than 250 people involved in the Wake Will campaign. Those engaged alumni are good testimony to the satisfaction and meaning that we all receive by being part of this large group working on behalf of the Wake Forest mission. And as part of that, I've been able to witness what Mark described, the enthusiastic response in Boston to events with the message, leading lives that matter. And for me, it helped make that connection with my Wake Forest education, thinking about my life today and in the future, a better connection than I'd ever understood before between my education at Wake Forest and my life, and particularly life after work. So Mark is right. This next slide shows that we did review some research. We're not researchers. And what we wanted to just bring to your attention is some research that we found important to support the correlation between leading a life that matters and successful aging. In 2014, in the book, The Upside of Aging, the chairman of the Center for Aging at the Milken Institute defines a future that differs profoundly from the retirement dreams of our parents and grandparents, a future where more of us reimagine retirement by declining mass leisure to work longer, pursue businesses, learning, and also impacting their communities through volunteerism and civic engagement. Last month, Stanford Center on Longevity issued a report of the Sightlines Project to spark a national conversation about the great deal people can do as they age to ensure satisfying long lives, and I see this conference adding a strong Wake Forest voice to that discussion. A higher sense of purpose in life is associated with longer lifespans. The next slide was an experience I had when I last year opened my Harvard magazine that goes to all the alumni to find an article, quote, "The Talent for Aging Well," unquote. This was a report on a study that Harvard started in 1941 to 1944 of Harvard's greatest generation. At that time, all men. So they followed 268 men for six decades. Now also reported in this book, Aging Well, they found that, and this I think is important for many of the things we've talked about today, especially re-engaging with your community, is that social aptitude, not intellectual brilliance or social class, leads to successful aging. As you heard earlier, socially isolated individuals actually die at younger ages. And many Harvard men who looked unimpressive at 46 had lives that became startlingly better as they aged. So there is a favorite quote, the next part of this slide. I wanted to emphasize the quote at the bottom. Not only if you think more of others, will your life be more satisfying? We now have research that actually lowers the mortality rate. A person with a higher sense of purpose in life was about half as likely to die over the next follow-up period in a longitudinal study at the Rush University Medical Center published in 1997. Also, we have seen, and you've heard this referred, I think, to here today as well, better cognitive results on tests and fewer depressive symptoms. So what does this mean for the Wake Forest community beyond those of you here today? Well, in 1910, only 1% of Harvard alumni were retired. Now look at 2016 and the story of Wake Forest. look at the size of individuals who could benefit from everything we're talking about here today. Focus on just a few numbers on this slide. Baby boomers who began retiring in 2012 will soon begin experiencing their 70s, life in the 70s. And behind them are even larger numbers. By 2031, the number of alumni reaching retirement age will double, a huge opportunity for connections with their alma mater, and especially for this kind of research effort. This means for the Wake Forest community there is more life after work than ever before, but the question we're addressing today is how to use this time. Mark and I found a couple of brief examples we wanted to bring to your attention. One is Stanford University's Distinguished Careers Institute, designed for established leaders from all walks of life. These participants seek to transform themselves, tapping into Stanford's resources for jobs and roles of social impact at the local, national, and global level. I read that to mean Stanford's version of leading lives that matter. Another interesting example was Kingsborough College, Community College, started a new program for aging for the individuals in Brooklyn, and they started with a class of 35 seats and a new course called Live Well, Do Well, Age Well. They billed this as the first class to teach the mastery of aging. 400 people applied for 35 seats. Now that actually means those individuals had a better chance of graduating from the Navy SEALs elite training program than they did getting a seat in this class. But it tells you something that I think sort of refers back to a comment Provost Kirsch made. Provost Kirsch said there's some members on the community always telling me Wake Forest is doing this wrong and Wake Forest should be doing that. Well, obviously, Mark and I don't see Wake Forest doing anything wrong, but we do say there's an opportunity and a growing opportunity in our alumni base to take these kind of ideas and research and extend it out. Why? We could leverage all that we're talking about here today and all that Wake Forest is already doing to elevate the beneficial pursuit of a new life course that's really modeled for Wake Forest Aging Well, that's built on what we aim to do for our undergraduates.
So, Wake Forest has so many wonderful programs aimed at our community. What if we could open those up? What if we could engage our alumni across the country and help them grow and learn and live well? Imagine the impact of a powerful, connected network of Wake Foresters dedicated to leading lives that matter. Imagine the impact we can have on our nation, our world, and importantly, ourselves as we see how to live well, do well, and age well. Thank you.
Okay. Our next talk is called The Embodied and Relational Nature of the Mind. This talk will be given by Dr. Jack Rogeski, who is a chaired professor in health and exercise sciences at Wake Forest University and associate chair of the Translational Science Center. You want to hold it?
Okay. So I'm going to speak from down here, and what I'm going to suggest you do first you can turn your back on me, it's fine, because that happens all the time in my classrooms. So you want to be able to see these, because all visual, pretty much the talk, and you really need to be able to see the slides. So if you can't, you'll miss out on some that might be important. So I want to begin by just thanking the organizational committee for inviting me here, and also joining many colleagues across the campus who have really helped my own career in biostatistical sciences, the Stick Center of Aging, and particularly the Laboratory of Complex Brain Networks, where I've spent some time for the last 6 or 7 years. So what am I going to do? I really want to talk about two specific questions. What does it mean to suggest that the mind is embodied and relational? And secondly, what are the implications of such a perspective for thriving, for a reimagined vision of aging? So in some ways, the way you can think about this, I thought about this after Steve gave his talk this morning, is that this is really the behavioral approach to doing what Steve and others are thinking about from a medication perspective. So So hopefully I'll be able to get this message across in 12 minutes. Basically, if you think about the brain, one of the things that we've learned over the years now is that it works through various networks. So it's not as if one part of the brain does this, another part does that. Paolo Ranieri has been really significant player in the field in terms of establishing the fact that the way the brain works is by networking. Well, the way that I look at the mind is that the mind really is a network that binds together the body, the brain, and relationships. So as I'm speaking to you today, you know, there's energy coming from you and from me. That energy is not the same kind of energy that passes between neurons, but it's very real energy. I can register it. It affects my brain. My brain can pass information down and also affect my body. It can affect relationships with you. So what are the implications of that definition for an aging society? I think they're actually pretty profound. And that is, I argue from a theoretical perspective that movement, and you'll see what I mean by movement in a minute, and relationships serve as a foundation for brain networks that basically support thriving across the lifespan. Now, mobility or movement is really important for two reasons. One is we usually think of the word mobility, but in truth, movement also is extremely important in establishing relationships. It's the way we establish our very first relationship. These relationships are formed with other people, but they're also formed with the world around us. And as I tell my students, the world is really a dynamic art museum if you really pay attention to what's going on. So embodiment, if you think about it, is largely enabled through movement. If you didn't get a chance to listen to Liz last night, you should. And she makes this point very clearly, I think. The interesting thing in my mind is that movement really has two very important dimensions to it. The one that you're going to think about probably first offhand is the spinal nerves that are in the spinal column, because they control our major movements, those which allow us to get here and to get up and down from our chairs and do various things we do day to day. So this really is the foundation for mobility. And the second really component of movement, though, is really a set of nerves. This is a very complex, I don't have a pointer, but there's a pink area you can see at the base of the brain. That's the brainstem. And in the brainstem, over the past couple of decades, what researchers have learned is that there's a network in there that's driven by the 10th nerve, cranial nerve, which is the vagus nerve. And Steve Porges, a colleague of mine, has actually found that the vagus nerve has multiple components to it. And one of the components is called the smart vagus. And it's really smart because what it does is it connects with the other cranial nerves in the brainstem, and it drives the muscles of the face, it drives the muscles of the inner ear, and it affects our lungs and it affects our heart. And this is the movement system that's active in a newborn infant, and it's the reason a newborn infant can connect with people and survive. So C. Porges calls this the social engagement system. This has changed the face of clinical psychology. If you read any new book in clinical psychology, this is the underwritten kind of message that you hear about the social engagement system. And actually, Charles Darwin back in the 1800s was correct when he said, when a heart is affected, so is the brain and vice versa. So when we have heartfelt emotions, they impact our brain in a very profound way. So I believe that grasping the nature of this, of thriving, requires really a lifespan perspective. And the reason for that, I'm going to focus for the next few minutes on these little guys. So even though we're interested in aging, the secret to thriving is really down here, I think. Pretty powerful picture. This is the social engagement system in action in the very early years of life. What's interesting is in the 1960s, Paul MacLean developed a concept called the triune brain. He originally developed this, believing that this is how the brain evolved. Neuroanatomists proved him wrong, but it turns out that psychologists and psychiatrists have held on to this idea because in working with people, you find out that you're dealing with a bit of a snake, a bit of a kangaroo, and a bit of a human. And that's true. A lot of our behaviors, if you watch the political scene these days, it's not driven It's not driven by rational thought, all right? So what's interesting about this paradigm is that in early infancy, I have a grandson, young Jack, who basically, when he was born, his brain was at this stage, so he didn't have hemispheres that controlled his behavior. He relied on his parents, and he relied on the social engagement system to basically regulate his emotions. And so this is the beginning of self-control over emotions that occurs between mother and child. Now, when you look at this, then you can realize that what is happening to this child is that as he's engaging with this mother, his vagus nerve is tuning his ears, adjusting the muscles in his ears so they can resonate to the soft voice of the mother. And he's responding to the facial cues of the mother. And that connection, all right, that connection is long lasting. It stays with you until you die. It's very, very powerful. This is another picture of a colleague of mine, Kate Callahan's son John, and her husband Jake, and he's playing the mandolin. And I think this is pretty powerful when you look at the hands, the connection with the father, and the eyes, the intent. And if you had a heart rate monitor on him, you would notice, I tried to put this on my son, grandson, but he wouldn't allow me to do so. But if you watched the heart rate monitor, you would see the vagus nerve go crazy. So you can actually monitor this by using patterns in heart rate rhythms. It's really fascinating. And what's other interesting thing about this is that I believe that music is a neural exercise. And it facilitates attachment. And one of the things that we're thinking about now in our new intervention is how do we incorporate, how do we build interventions around these ideas? So this is my grandson a little older, and when attachment goes right, people get very curious, they explore things, they move all around, and they begin to use their mobility, they begin to use this second system, this spinal system, to actually move and explore, as he's doing here with his football. What's interesting is for the next 12 to 15 months of life, really what's happening is there's a big spurt of growth in the right hemisphere of your brain. And this part of your brain is the emotional, nonverbal, embodied, and non-conceptual side of your brain, which I call, and other people have, the non-conceptual or embodied self. It's in every one of us. It's part of who we are. Not that we really pay attention to it a lot, but it's part of who we are. And what's interesting is, in recent times, you're seeing a lot of interest in mindfulness. You're seeing interest in dance for older people. What is that? It's connecting with this non-conceptual self. That's why they're so powerful. That's why they feel so good, and that's why I think you're going to see a whole lot more of it in the future. When the embodied non-conceptual self is really alive, this is my grandson again, it's really amazing. So then what happens over the next 50 years is that we go to school and we interact with our parents, and like a good Western society, we reinforce the growth of the left hemisphere. This is our rational, language-based, cerebral, and conceptual self. And so what happens with time is that we now develop an identity, a second identity called the conceptual self, our self-esteem. All right? We have to have that. We need that. It's actually probably the thing we shouldn't be building. What we should be building is a non-conceptual self, ironically. And that's what we need to do in our schools, I think. That's what we need to do in our classrooms. So anyways, what's interesting is a favorite author of mine, if you like to read fairly deep books. Ian Gilchrist, who's a neurologist, wrote a phenomenal book on basically Western society and how the focus is on the development of the left hemisphere and the dangers of that, and how there's, over time, he actually tracks the corpus callosum, which is a connection between two hemispheres, and shows that there's been a reduction of the volume of that. So essentially, we kind of have like a left hemisphere on steroids. That's kind of the way I think of modern society. You see this in the changing nature of play behavior, which is really sad. And you see this as people disengage with relationships and engage in mindless movement. You know, we forgot how to move as we did when we were children. That's what we need to rediscover. That's kind of what Barb Nicholas and I have a grant from NIH, and we're going to try to infuse some of this into that project. So what happens is there's this gradual erosion of embodied movement and relationships in our culture. I think middle age, you start to see this stuff even or as early as adolescence as some of the students that I teach. So it's frightening, to say the least. So essentially, the scaffolding that supports critical networks experience premature aging, in my view. What happened? Moves forward to 65, so we're almost done here. What do we see? In some cases, there obviously people thrive well, but in some cases, you see extreme examples of disengagement in relationships. And unfortunately, as time passes, people lose their mobility. What's fascinating is kind of the cycle of life, is that in a childhood, it's sort of the cranial nerves that are your first form of movement. You move to the spinal, and when you age, you know, in some cases, the social engagement system declines because you don't develop relationships, very much what we're just talking about with connections with other people, it doesn't happen. And what happens is you lose mobility, your life space decreases, and that leads to, you know, a reduction, obviously, in a decomposition of those other networks. And so severe decline in the scaffolding that I've just been building up. So the good news is, I think there's a solution. We've initiated and continue to work on the development of interventions that really tap in to this mindful engagement self. And our goal is to really help older adults rediscover the non-conceptual self. And this, I think this curious, engaging child resides in every one of us. And to me, that really is kind of the reimagined vision for aging society. So I want to leave you one last quote. This was a quote that was written by Albert Einstein to a rabbi whose young daughter died, and he was looking to Albert for advice. And I'll read it to you since you may not be able to see it. A human being is part of us, a whole caused by just the universe, a part limited in time and space. He experiences himself, his thoughts and feelings as something separate from the rest, a kind of optical delusion of his consciousness. This delusion is kind of a prison for us, restricting us to the personal desires and to a fiction for a few persons nearest to us. Our task must be to free ourselves from this prison by widening our circle of compassion to embrace all living creatures and the whole of nature in its beauty. That's all I'm in there. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, thank you, Jack. Our next speaker is Laura Baker, who's an associate professor in the Department of Internal Medicine, the section on geriatrics. Her talk is entitled, Aerobic Exercise Reduces Phosphorylated Tau Protein in Cerebrospinal Fluid in Older Adults with Mild Cognitive Impairment. It's about dementia and Alzheimer's, I think. but here she is, Dr. Baker.
I like to scare people with my titles. And then it's just, it'll wake you up, hopefully. And so my real title is up on the screen there. It was just a trick. Just to see if you were paying attention. So I'm at Wake, I'm over at the Stick Center, and I study how to prevent Alzheimer's disease. Who cares about that in this room? Anyone? Has anyone not been touched by Alzheimer's disease in here? Not. And I don't mean personally. Does everyone in this room know someone with a memory impairment or someone who's battling Alzheimer's disease? Okay, if you don't, you will. Within 5 years, my prediction is you will. The numbers are climbing, and so we're all at a fast race to see what we can do to prevent this disease. My particular area of research is something we all have accessibility to. It's something that we all wish we didn't have to do, but we all know that we should, and that is exercise. How many people have considered adding exercise to their life? You don't have to have done it. How many people are thinking about it? All right, hold that thought. So as we get older, the brain changes. That's no surprise to anyone in this room. The positives, we acquire more information, right? So our knowledge base increases. That's the beauty of getting older. We become wiser. Compared to when we were younger, we can identify priorities better, which can benefit our intellectual pursuits. All right, that's what we hang on to. That's my positive change with age. The negatives, I think most of us in this room, no matter what age, if you're 25 or older, you have started to feel this. But as we get older, there are negative consequences. We have more difficulties remembering new information. We have difficulty remembering names of people and places and things and books. We have more difficulty multitasking. Is any of this sounding familiar to anyone? Okay, good. Then you are among friends. And we have more difficulty thinking quickly. These are all the consequences of aging that's normal for all of us. But aging can have some of us go through the natural process of aging. We experience normal changes. The picture I'm showing you here in the bottom in the gray on the left is, you can't really see them from where you're sitting, but there are two brains here. And it's just a picture of a brain as if you had a slice of the head and it's missing here, gone. On the left is a normal, is a 25-year-old brain. On the right is an older adult who now is experiencing significant cognitive impairment. And so some of us are fortunate enough to go through life experiencing only the natural, normal, age-related changes in brain. Some of the things that I talked about a minute ago in terms of the troubles we have, these are the normal changes that we experience. However, there's a large growing number of us who experience significant cognitive decline as we age. This is not a natural process by any means. This is a disease. And so, you know, our question is, how do we slow down? How do we prevent? How do we stop? How do we treat this progression from normal, healthy, older adults to a condition that can debilitate us significantly in our ability to live our lives? As Dr. Kaczewski said earlier, our goals here are not to live longer, but to live better, live the years that we have to their fullest extent. How do we help these people? How do we help these people live life in that way to the best of our ability? We were built to move. Yet our culture and lifestyle progressively encourage minimization of movement. We sit more than we do 20 years ago. We drive more than we did 50 years ago. We engage in physically active occupations and leisure activities less now than ever. Older adults are among the least active of anyone. So the standard minimum recommendation we all hear about from the American Heart Association, the CDC, you name it, get 150 minutes of exercise per week. And this is standard minimum recommendation. This chart here that I have on the right shows, if you can't see anything, the last two bars are what age group? Yes, 65 and older. 65 and older get the least amount of exercise, and actually on average, in a 24-hour period, 15 minutes a day. 15. Don't make me add up the number of minutes in a day. So physical activity, we all know this. We've learned this long ago. We know that physical activity protects the body against many conditions and diseases that accelerate aging. Physical activity can restore health to multiple sick biological systems in the body. You may be already convinced that regular exercise can protect against conditions like obesity, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, cancer, frailty, the list goes on. Do you have any confidence now that physical activity can protect your brain as you get older? So this is the question scientists have been trying to answer now for a number of years. What if this is true? So what I have here is a kind of the prelude for why we study exercise. There is a wealth of experiments in animals showing these amazing benefits of regular exercise. Animals loved it. Some animals love to exercise. Rats and rodents, you can get them to exercise very easily. Monkeys, good luck. But rats and rodents love to exercise. And we know from these studies that when they exercise on a regular basis, things change magically in the brain. The blood vessels, there's growth in the blood vessels. There's protection of the cells that are likely to die. These cells last longer when there's injury or toxicities around. There's reduced inflammation, and there's less Alzheimer's pathology in the cells in brains. That's amazing. So we get these animal results, and we say, oh, we have to try this on people. What if this is a miracle non-pharmacological intervention? So in people, so far, what we know in some human studies is that there is a signal that, yes, it may protect cognitive function as we get older. And most of the work that's been done so far is in healthy, naturally aging older adults, not sick. And we find out that their memory and thinking skills can improve. Their blood flow in the brain improves, but in cognitively healthy older adults. So there's been a number of studies now based, because of these exciting animal and early people studies that want to look at the controlled effects. And I mean, the people going into the studies, they are not regular exercisers, because there may be something different about those people. They may have a different diet or live in a different part of the country or live in a less polluted area. The new studies now that are coming out are all called controlled trials, where people come in and they're all the same. They're all sedentary. They have not been exercising, and then they're randomized to one group or another. And so this is really the best way to see if it's the exercise and not something else in their life that's impacting the change. So what I'm showing you here, and I'm sorry, these can't see it very well, so let me just tell you very quickly. In the top panel, I'm showing you a representative brain. This is just kind of the mean brain of several people, several participants in a study. And you really can't see much except some colors. You see the colors on the screen? The colors represent, now, believe it or not, the colors represent areas of growth, brain growth, during 6 months of exercise. These people are all sedentary when they started. It's never too late is one message. It's your take-home message number one. It's never too late. These people are 65 and older, brain growth in key regions that support cognitive function. In the bottom panel, the colors, again, show increased activity in a critical brain region that is first compromised in people with early Alzheimer's disease. So these people in the bottom panel, they're all in the gray zone between normal and Alzheimer's disease. They have mild cognitive impairment. So they have an impairment. They're still getting around from point A to point B like all of us in this room. These people, after 6 months of exercise, have increased activity in a vulnerable area of the brain. So we are in a crisis time right now with respect to the growing numbers of people with memory impairments, older adults with memory impairment, and the all-time high number of people with dementia, and Alzheimer's disease in particular. As of 2016, I have pills up here with a big no sign in front of it. So far in 2016, we do not have a medical treatment to prevent or slow this disease. However, we have a number of new promising interventions that are being studied now, and some of them at our Alzheimer's Prevention Center right down the road. I'm at Wake Forest, the Stick Center. So we have hope that we'll have something down the road, but right now there are no medical treatments to stop the disease. The one area of focus in our research center at the Alzheimer's Center is lifestyle. Can lifestyle, and in particular aerobic exercise, protect against cognitive decline and Alzheimer's disease? All right, so I'm going to tell you about a study that we've just completed here at Wake Forest. We have a catchy name. Always catchy name is important to a successful trial. Piedmont Triad Aging Cognition Exercise Study, the PACE study. Our question was, can exercise, regular, structured, high-intensity exercise, change the trajectory? Can it slow disease? Can it improve the symptoms associated with cognitive impairment? So all of our people, all of our participants had mild cognitive impairment. They were all in the gray zone. They're all at high risk for developing dementia. So why exercise? The difference between exercise and a drug. Drugs are great for honing in on a target, a biological target, focusing on that target, changing that target to restore health. If that's the problem, then a drug is good. When we have a disease that affects multiple biological systems, we may need a multifaceted approach. And so this is why exercise may be more beneficial for this kind of disease. So our design is one where we have a 6-month intervention. We randomize people to an aerobic training or a stretching group. Stretching is our control. Everyone has mild cognitive impairment. Our outcomes have to do with, we look at proteins in the cerebral spinal fluid. That is the fluid that surrounds the brain that gives us the closest estimate of what's going on inside the brain. We have brain imaging where we look at the changes in the structure and the blood flow and cognitive assessments. I'm not going to go into our intervention except that you can come talk to me about them later. If people always want to know how much is enough. We can talk about this, but let me tell you that it's 6 months. It was supervised at the YMCAs. It's structured. It's high intensity versus a stretching. And both groups get all the same social interaction. The only difference is their heart rate during this time. So one of our questions had to do with what's in the cerebral spinal fluid. What is the marker? Is there a change in the Alzheimer biological marker in response to exercise? So one of the major analyses that we had, it had to do with looking at tau protein. Now tau is the important protein that plays a role in tangles. You've all heard of plaques and tangles and Alzheimer's disease. Well, tau is the critical protein that's involved in the formation of tangles. So if we can see a reduction in tau protein in response to exercise, it suggests to us that exercise is changing the pathology of the disease in the brain. And so what I'm showing you here on your right is that what we found is that with people who are over the age of 70, let's look at the far two bars, we saw a reduced amount of this tau protein, this Alzheimer protein in the cerebral spinal fluid. That's the red bar going down. And compare it to the blue bars, which is the stretching group. In the younger adults, which are the bars on the left, we saw no change. So this is a over 70 phenomenon. In cognition, we see, we can think of these bars as like a sum total of a type of test scores that measure your ability to plan, initiate, multitask, pay attention. And these kinds of tasks that help you to focus your attention on your environment right in front of you and organize your life, aerobic exercise, 6 months of aerobic exercise improved cognitive function for these individuals, and we saw a decline in the stretching control group. Remember, all of our people are in the gray zone. We already expect a change for these people, a decline in 6 months, and that's what we saw in the stretching group. Okay, and then the last findings that I'm going to share with you today have to do with the brain imaging. I have two findings to show you. One, I'm showing you in this, again, you can't see it well, but I'm telling you that what I'm showing you in these pictures, that kind of think of them as a mean brain imaging picture, the areas that are circled are areas where we typically see shrinkage as the disease progresses from mild cognitive impairment to Alzheimer's disease. Do you see the yellow circles? These are the areas we typically see shrinkage. The yellow areas are exactly the areas where we saw brain growth in this study, okay? And then finally, I'm showing you here changes. This is what we're very excited about this. These are all the colored areas all show areas of the brain where there was increased blood flow. So in the red area, the blue area, and the green area, we saw increased blood flow in the aerobic group, but not the stretching group. Now, what's important about these areas is these are the areas, the red area is affected. You typically see a decline in blood flow with normal aging in the red area. We have increased it. In the blue area, you typically see a decline in blood flow with early Alzheimer's disease. We see an increase. So I think my parting words for you are, can exercise protect the brain as we age? I've shown you some evidence to suggest that maybe this is the case. It's up to you to decide. Is it worth the sweat? And I leave you finally with this picture of how to find us. Again, we are right down the road. We work with the community heavily to prevent this disease and identify treatments that are going to add quality of life to those who are losing it faster than we would like it to be the case. So thank you.
Okay, our next talk is Improvisation, a Lifelong Skill for Brain-Body Health. It will be given by the Christinas, Dr. Christina Hugenschmidt, who's an assistant professor also in the internal medicine and section on gerontology, and Professor Christina Soriano from theater and dance.
All right, so we're going to get you guys moving in a second, but right now, my friend Christina is moving, and she is alternating, making circles and angular shapes with her body. She's making movement choices that are not choreographed. In fact, she is improvising. So improvisation is the ability to create new gestures and movements on the spur of the moment. In improvisation, pre-planned or prescriptive movements are replaced by self-generated responses. So Christina, can you keep doing what you're doing, but now dramatically change your speed and add distinct pauses?
Sure.
All right. Improvisation doesn't imply that people are free to do whatever they want. That's kind of a misconception. While Christina's material may be unplanned or unexpected, it's not random. Instead, improvisation allows her to move within an environment structured by select constraints. At any moment, I could give her a different prompt and elicit new movement choices, like, Christina, do what you're doing, but now change your relationship with the ground. Okay. These prompts help her to stay curious about all the different ways that her body is capable of moving. Suddenly, her chair is a dance partner or a new way to move her weight, not just an object on which to sit. All forms of dance use improvisation, but improvisation can be studied as a form in and of itself, and it is worth practicing for its own sake. It is also a valid topic for neuroscience research. So I am Christina Hugenschmidt, and I am a neuroscience researcher.
And I'm Christina Soriano, and I'm a dancer. I teach here at Wake in the theater and dance department. And since 2012, I have been so fortunate to work with older adults who have neurodegenerative diseases. In the dance studio, we dance together. And I believe now more than ever that classes in movement improvisation are invaluable for people's cognitive, physical, emotional, and social well-being. Today we're going to talk a little bit about our ongoing collaboration and some of the things we're learning together about improvisational dance and the brain. I start with an obvious yet profound reality. The only constant in our lives is change. And so our belief is that practicing movement improvisation allows us to practice reacting to change. Movement can become limited during normal aging, and for people living with neurodegenerative diseases, movement, gait, and balance can be a risky business. As a dancer and choreographer, my colleague and mentor, Glenna Batson, and I were curious about the idea of improvisational dance for people living with Parkinson's. Many studies with Parkinson's, tango or Tai Chi, were showing favorable results for PD patients. But as we considered what so many symptoms common in PD are, freezing episodes, frequent tremors, stooped posture, dystonia, rigidity, movement improvisation warranted attention in scientific research. As physical spontaneity is robbed so often for people living with PD, the case for improvisation was an obvious one for us. In 2012, we completed a pilot study graciously funded by the Translational Science Center, where we hypothesized that improvisation as an intervention could introduce movement problem-solving skills in daily living. I'm going to show a clip now from this study in 2012 that shows two subjects from the study, both of whom continue to take the class 4 years later on a regular basis with us. And what I want to show you is not just the range of motion that you can see increase in these two people, but I want you to notice also the fluidity with which they move in the before intervention and after intervention shots. The woman on the left, Debbie, this is her getting out of the chair before, and on the right is her getting out of the chair after a 7-week study. Watch again. Next slide. This is my friend Eunice. On the left is her raising her arm and cross-laterally moving to her knee on the other side of her body, before and after, left and right. That's good, thanks.
Part of the study, they saw differences in balance scores and a scale that's commonly used by physical therapists to look at fall risk. In addition to that, they saw improvements that I'm going to show you in just a second on brain imaging. Before we dive into the data, though, we wanted to thank some people. This work is very collaborative, and that means it involves a real village, a sort of a scientific and social village that includes other colleagues, support staff like Phyllis Babcock sitting over there, and Paul Lorienti in the Laboratory for Complex Brain Networks, who are sitting over there, and a lot of collaborators to pull this together, as well as the study participants, some of whom are also in the audience, and we like to thank them. And students. A couple of fabulous students, especially Rachel Kasky and Courtney Mason. So I'm going to show you some brain imaging pictures, and I just want to orient you to what you're going to be looking at. The slides I'm going to show you are all going to look like this. And what this is a slice through the brain, which you can see on the right, that's taken through the middle. And when you look at these, the front of the brain is going to be toward the top, and the back of the brain is going to be toward the back. So when Glenna and Christina did their first study, the Laboratory for Complex Brain Networks was kind enough to scan a participant for them, even though they didn't have any funding. So this is the results from that one person. And you can see before training, what we're looking at here in green is an area of the brain called the basal ganglia. The basal ganglia are very important for voluntary movement, and they are directly attacked, basically, in Parkinson's disease. And this is what results in a lot of the movement problems that people in Parkinson's have. This particular kind of analysis answers the age-old question of who are the people in your neighborhood? And what you can see right now is that the basal ganglia are pretty lonely. They are in a neighborhood all by themselves. After the intervention, they have some friends. And the friends they have are an area called premotor cortex that's important for movement planning and movement generation. So now, as a result of the intervention, not only are you seeing physical differences in their automaticity of their movement, in clinical measures like a clinical measure of balance, but we're also able to see that reflected in a change in brain networks. And so it turns out that Parkinson's disease is not the only neurological disease associated with aging that can affect gait. So in fact, although Alzheimer's disease is typically thought of as a loss of memory, there are a lot of other things that go with it, including gait and movement changes. In fact, changes in gait speed can happen up to 12 years before we can detect cognitive change on a test. In addition, falling is one of the main reasons that people with Alzheimer's disease can be admitted to a hospital. So movement is an important part of this disease. Christina and I decided to ask, we were curious, is this kind of intervention that she does, is it possible to apply that to someone having cognitive change? And if so, what would happen? So we had people with early stage dementia and their caregivers participate in an 8-week group, an 8-week class, where they came in twice a week. And it was a small pilot study. We measured balance, and we again saw changes and improvements in balance. And this time we looked at brain imaging in more than one person. It's a whopping 5, but it is more than one. So you're looking here at a similar picture, asking that question of who are the people in our neighborhood. And now we're looking at an area of the brain called the primary motor cortex. It's called primary because it is important for movement and for motor movements. Here, what the color is showing is how many people have that brain area in their neighborhood. And in this case, blue means not very many, and red is going to mean a lot. At the top of the image, you can see our control group. And in the bottom, you can see the people who did dance. And these two images are from baseline, so they haven't done any dance interventions yet, and you can see they look about the same. Here are the pictures after 8 weeks of dance. And what you see here is the people in the control group still look about the same. But the people who were in the dance group showed big changes in the consistency of their motor networks. So this is a small study. We see it as a starting point. But we think that it shows that there's a lot of promise for this kind of work that can have meaningful consequences for people emotionally, socially, in terms of physical function, and also neurally.
We believe improvisation is a requirement for living. It's a skill that demands instantaneous reaction, self-direction, and self-motivation. It requires risk-taking, nimbleness, and an ability to react to change. It does not develop from self-judgment, but from self-confidence, trust in others, curiosity, and believing that your body can respond in the best way, in the moment, to the situation at hand. These are all things we want. Anyone who can practice these life skills gains momentum to live intentionally and attentively. In so much as improvisation is automatic, it's also something that we need to practice. Just like we need to exercise, we need to dance. So let's practice improvising a little together. What I'd like you to do now is an exercise that I call Shapes and Pathways, and I'd like to draw to your attention to some of my favorite dancers in the room who regularly attend my Parkinson's class on Wednesdays. Can I say hey to you guys? So if you get lost, just follow them, because they are really good dancers. Okay, so Shapes and Pathways works like this. Sitting in your chair, nice and tall, just make a shape with your upper body. Any shape will do. Beautiful. Make a new shape that's distinctive from the one you've just made. Go back to the first shape. Good. Find a way now to go back to the original shape, but create a different pathway in which to get there. Yeah, you should see how beautiful this all looks. Okay, good. Now, make a third shape. Can you go back to the first shape? New pathway, first shape to third shape. Go. Good. Now, let's just move with the right side of our upper body and the left side of our lower body. Go. Right side, upper, left side, lower. Good. And switch, left side upper, right side lower. Good. Now go back to the right side upper, left side lower, and cross the midline of the body in as many ways as you can for 10 seconds. Go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Good, rest. Okay, I'll give you a break. Good work, everybody. That looked great. So, we want to finish by saying that life is improvisation. Stay curious. Play. Move. And I want to finish with a quote by a good friend of mine who works for Kinder Music. She said to me, "You know, Christina, what you're doing makes so much sense because we're never not children. Our bodies just get older." Thank you.
Okay, our next speaker, Our next speaker is Sam Matthews, who's the executive director of the Shepherd Center of Greater Winston-Salem, and his talk is entitled "A Model for Successful Aging."
I'm surprised that there's still people here. I figured most of you would be gone by now, but it is really a pleasure to be here on behalf of the Shepherd Center to share with you some exciting things that we're doing. I'm really glad that there are people here who know us well. There are people who are volunteers with us and participants with us, board members and former board members, so I thank you for being here. Every month at our board meetings, we have a mission emphasis where we have an individual talk to us about their involvement with the Shepherd Center, either as a volunteer or a participant or maybe someone who receives our services. Judy was with us last Monday. She had moved to this community about 5 or 6 years ago to be close to her son. She was doing that because she had been diagnosed as being legally blind because of macular degeneration. Once she moved here, unfortunately, she had two strokes, one after the other. Following the recuperation and rehabilitation for that, one of the hospital social workers gave her some information about agencies in the community that might be able to help her. And one of her needs was transportation to medical appointments. She had a number of those. So she began to, she contacted us and began having transportation regularly through volunteers that work with us in providing transportation for older adults. Those volunteers not only transport, but they communicate and listen and get involved with the people that they're serving to, again, find out what their meaning and interests are in life. The volunteers found that she was interested in knitting and crocheting. And she said, "Well, do you know that there's a group like that at the Shepherd Center?" She said, "Well, I'm blind and I don't know that I could do that very well." She said, "Well, come on and do that." After 3 weeks, she was knitting and crocheting and making things, as all of the other group members do, that are donated out in the community, like caps for premature babies and things of that nature. On one of her trips, one of the volunteers found that she enjoyed dancing. But she was not able to do that anymore, according to her, at that point. So she said, "Well, why don't you come and do some line dancing at the Shepherd Center?" And so she did, and now she's dancing just about every weekend in different parts of the community. One of the volunteers suggested that maybe because she was experiencing some kind of balance problems, that maybe Tai Chi for arthritis might be a good thing for her to get involved in. And so now she's participating in that on a weekly basis. The other thing that she became very interested in is our lifelong learning series, which takes place every spring and fall. She has really immersed herself into that and said that she was learning quite a bit. The thing that was most poignant as she finished was that she indicated that before I became involved with the Shepherd Center, she said, "I was just existing. I was living in my house, just existing." As she said, watching many, many episodes of The Golden Girls. She said, "Now I have a life." And that, to me, is the mission and purpose of the Shepherd Center, where we are a model for promoting and supporting successful aging. What I would like to share with you briefly is, to begin with, is one of the resources that has informed our thinking and work around what we do in the community. This comes from the MacArthur Foundation study on successful aging, which was done in 1998. Significant in that study and the outcomes was that it effectively destroyed some common negative myths about aging, particularly that illness accompanies aging or that mental capacity diminishes with aging. A few of the other items that were listed in there, and you may not be able to see these very well, are physical activity, which we've experienced and heard a lot about how important that is, that social activities and participating with other groups and with individuals was very important. Volunteer activities or work was extremely important in successful aging. And that participants who had chronic conditions when they began this particular study experienced positive and protective effects of exercise and socialization, which we've heard about last night and today. And the physical activity provided protection against cognitive decline. This study also concluded with some very key elements about what compromised or what comprised successful aging. One was that there was a low risk of disease and disability, a high mental and physical function, and active engagement with life. And it emphasized that lifestyle choices are more important than a heredity, and that it also addressed society's role in promoting successful aging, which is, again, one of the cornerstones of what we're trying to do in terms of what we're doing in the community. This can be graphically illustrated this way in terms of bringing together the avoidance of disease, the engagement with life, and physical and mental functioning. Now imagine if we had a model in the community which offered a broad range of programs and services for older adults, which enriched the quality of life in later years, educated for informed decisions, serves the needs of older adults, supports healthy and active lifestyles and independent lifestyles, and inspires people's lives with meaning and purpose. Let's see. This program also, if you could imagine that, would involve and sustain older adults who desire to live independently in their own community. And it strengthens programs for older adults by building on coalitions that exist in the community already, provides opportunities for older adults to use their experience and strengths and wisdom and skills in service to other people, and enhances life satisfaction and meaning by discovering the inner resources through lifelong learning, caring relationships, creative expression, and community service. Well, that model is a reality, and the Shepherd Center model addresses life satisfaction, health promotion, and wellness as far as meaning and purpose. It offers an open-ended view of the later years as positive, exciting, and a meaningful period of a person's life. Our focus, and I heard this last night from Dr. Olshansky, is that it's really not to add life to years, but to add years, not to add years to life, but to add life to years. And that's what we believe that we're doing. This particular model, I think, was a visionary model that was begun nearly 40 years ago by the Reverend Dr. Elbert Cole in the Midwest. And it grew eventually to 100 national affiliates, of which we're one of those. There are four in North Carolina. There are two, fortunately, here in Forsyth County. And we all seek to redefine and restructure the way Americans, and particularly our communities, approach aging. Our mission with the Shepherd Center of Greater Winston-Salem, and we serve about 80% of Forsyth County, 80 to 85%, is to really, we are an interfaith community-based organization that promotes and supports successful aging by providing direct services, volunteer opportunities, and enrichment opportunities for older adults. We do that through three program areas that are all very active and engaged. One is our Faith in Action Care Program. The second is our Vital Living Program, or our Senior Center Program. And then lastly is our Congregational Nurse and Health Ministry Program. Our Faith in Action Program serves about 1,700 older adults each year with transportation to medical appointments and grocery shopping, provides minor home repairs either with individual volunteers or groups and teams of volunteers in the community, and then provides volunteer respite and caregiver visitation. Our Vital Living Program is really, from the state's perspective, the State Division on Aging and Adult Services is a model center without walls. We have about 12 locations throughout Forsyth County where we have activities for active older adults. Have about 45 activities a week. As you can see on this list, Tai Chi and yoga, we have combined about 8 classes a week in those particular disciplines. Computer classes, arts and crafts, fellowship opportunities, a host of bridge groups for all levels, lifelong learning program every spring and fall, as I mentioned, driver safety classes, beach trips, and a new effort called Tech Buddies, which combines Crosby Scholars with our older adults trying to navigate some of, whether it's an iPod or an iPhone or a new laptop that someone has given them for Christmas. It was exciting to see these young folks and the older adults working together in this way. And they really became friends in a very short period of time. A program that we began in 2009, which we felt like would engage either semi-retired or retired health professionals, particularly nurses in the community, was our Congregational Nurse and Health Ministry Program. And we are supporting a network of congregations. To date, about 62 that we have worked with that are affecting the lives of over 50,000 individuals in our community. And these individuals in their congregations are promoting health and wellness through their training. It's not a hands-on kind of nursing thing, but it's basically promoting health and wellness, whether it's diet, exercise, those types of things for the individuals in their congregations as well as their communities. And we have worked with a number of partners in having that become a reality, both Faith Health North Carolina, Wake Forest Baptist Medical Center, Novant Health, the Winston-Salem State School of Nursing, and the Forsyth County Department of Health have been active partners in that. This past year, we reached a milestone in just about every area that we were working in. We served almost a little over 4,900 individuals. We had over 15,000 requests for services that we responded to. Had 450 active volunteers engaged in what we are doing, and if any of you want to become active as volunteers to help add years to your life, please join us and see me afterwards. Those volunteers invested 47,000 hours in this community, which brought value-wise nearly $1 million into this community that would have had to been borne by some other entities. Specifically, our Vital Living Program for active older adults had an attendance of over 31,000 in the various activities that we offer each week and impacted the lives of about over 2,500 individuals. The slide you see here, I think, to me, says a lot about who we are and what we do. The lady on the left plays bridge once a week. We have about 8 bridge groups. She celebrated her 101st birthday earlier this year. She's very active. In fact, she runs some of the younger, older adults in the ground with her bridge playing. The gentleman on the right is 91 years old. He's a World War II vet. He comes every Tuesday and Thursday at 7:30 in the morning to help volunteers get organized to sort and price books for our annual book sale, which is our major fundraising event, which is coming up in the first weekend in May. These people find meaning and purpose for what they're doing. In fact, the gentleman that works in our book center recently had an automobile accident, and his daughter regularly calls us to say he needs something else to do. He can't get out just yet, but bring him books, bring him something, come visit him. He needs that stimulation and that meaning to him. This is a picture that I like and I've used a lot of times about Harriet Thompson, who at 92 became the oldest woman to complete a marathon. Don't we all wish at 92 we could be even upright and walking well, in addition to running a marathon. The Milken Institute was mentioned just earlier. Last year, through the White House Conference on Aging, I learned about a study that they had done on cities that were promoting successful aging. Out of the 100, Winston-Salem was number 79. Two of the areas identified on there, if you can see it very well in red, that we needed to do improvement in was wellness. Interestingly or not, we were very high on health care, but very low on wellness. And then secondly, transportation and convenience to get to where you want to go, whether it's walking or transportation. These are things that the Shepherd Center is working towards every day. And then lastly, you may have seen in the paper a week or so ago, a good successful aging that's coming here in October. Doc Severinsen, at 88 years old, is still actively playing his trumpet after many years on the Johnny Carson show, and we'll be here in October, and we hope that will be the epitome of successful aging in this community. So, thank you very much.
Could all the speakers from the session come up now, and then we'll have questions? Well, who's running the microphones? No, you're going to have to stay here. Should be on. It's out of power. Yeah, go ahead.
We always ask for four times a week for 45 minutes because we know we'll get three. But four is our prescription.
Hi, would you speak more, where's Sam? Sam, to the that dichotomy between health, where we're a healthy city or region, but we, what was that again, please? It woke me up. I missed.
Well, as I understood, the study results of that is we have a wonderful medical community here with wellness opportunities or health care opportunities and health care services. We as individuals are not exercising as much. We're sedentary too much. And as you saw on some of the slides, as we get older, we tend to do less and less of that. I think that is where, from a successful aging standpoint, we need to do a better job, and I think everybody here was addressing that.
My turn? This one's for Dr. Baker. I am in a current PACE study, which does not sound anything like the one that you just mentioned. Are they related? Can you tell me? If they are related, did the study that you mentioned inform in a real significant way further PACE studies like the one I'm in?
Okay, we did this just to confuse you.
Damn your face.
This was my study was PACE 2. I did not mention that. It's like you're in a different PACE study.
They're not
so
related.
Your results are different, but I'm happy to talk to you about that. I do know about that PACE study. So you
and the aspects of this PACE study I'm in are similar.
Yes, they are. We have different goals, but
okay.
Yes, similar.
Cool.
If there aren't any other questions.
No, we do. For someone who has Alzheimer's and there, you said that generally their gait changes before you start to notice other symptoms of Alzheimer's. If you have someone who is in a healthcare system and they are at the time that they come in, they're mobile, does their ability to stay mobile slow down that cognitive loss? Because it seems that what I've noticed is once they begin to stop walking, they're not as mobile, there's a sudden decline that then begins to slow a little bit, but it continues to decline. If you can keep them up on their feet, keep them somewhat mobile, does that continue to slow that?
This is not necessarily an easy question to answer. So there, I hear you asking two different things. One is about kind of the order of the gait slowing and the cognitive change. And there are studies that kind of show evidence of both. There are definitely, the study that I mentioned that showed that gait speed, so the pace, the rate at which you walk, was changing up to 12 years beforehand, was interesting because they did a pegboard test with the hands, and then they did the gait speed walking. The pegboard test changed after the diagnosis of cognitive impairment. The walking speed changed before. That being said, that's not necessarily the pattern that you're going to see in every person. And I would say that in general, the longer that you can keep somebody healthy and moving for many different reasons, that's going to help prolong their health cognitively and physically. I'm going to let Laura answer this question, but one other thing I'd add to that with physical health in people with cognitive decline is that when people are having cognitive decline, it's kind of a systemic disease in that it affects the entire family. There's usually a primary caregiver like a spouse or a daughter, but often there's a whole team of caregivers. And helping someone to maintain physical health so that they are less physically dependent on those caregivers can have its own set of bonuses for the caregiver, as well as helping the person who's having the cognitive decline. But I'll let Laura expand as well.
The only other thing I'd like to add is just in general for a cognitively impaired person, deprivation of any sort will increase the speed of trajectory of decline. Any type, emotional, psychological, physical, sensory, any type of deprivation will speed things along. So the question is there any difference in speed of decline when you keep them at home versus in a more socially stimulating environment? And I think, if we were to say in general, across the board, anytime there is increased stimulation, so it's hard to generalize because at home it can be wild. So who knows what the stimulation is at home, but as long as there's increased stimulation, your chance of slowing it down is greater. And so each family has to decide what's the best type of stimulation for that person. Stressful stimulation is not the good kind. It has to be a stimulation that's not creating more stress reaction by the person, because that can actually slow things down. So. So that you're talking about stress of the people taking care of the person, possibly, right?
And another view would be to put him in the assisted living, but he's going to resist that because he's a difficult person.
Mm-hmm.
That would create stress.
Kate, do you want to speak to this? Do you want to answer? I'd like to turn to someone who knows more than I do.
No, I don't know about that. At the Elder Law Clinic, we work with a lot of families in that situation. And one resource that I think was mentioned by Senior Services is the adult day centers. And there are several in the community. Kathy Long, raise your hand, is the director, wonderful person, used to work in the Stick Center. It's a nationally recognized program. I know Mount Zion Church has an excellent adult day center. It is not always easy to get a person to go there, and what some families have done is go for lunch there. And my experience, having gone there with clients and their families, just gotten in the car after the appointment and gone there, is that the person who's impaired doesn't want to leave. They like it so much. They're really, really good.
I can say that it is an excellent facility because my mother went there for a couple days a week prior to her needing to go to assisted living. But this particular person that I was discussing is extremely difficult. And he will not stay with anyone, he will not go anywhere, and he's in front of the TV most of the day.
So I think if you have more questions about it, that's something probably to bring up individually.
Yeah.
Are there any other questions?
I just wanted to add one thing. I know there are Wake Forest alumni in the room, and I wanted to give Mr. Peterson and Dr. Cooper a chance to briefly talk about some of the ways alumni, your voices can be heard, and also community members who care about Wake Forest, who I know you're all here. ways that you can also speak about the things that you care about. You have the ear of the VP of University Advancement. So I would, now's a chance to do that. But I wanted to share anything you wanted to add about that.
Usually I get asked for money, so I was, thank you. I did want to just say that we're at a very experimental stage right now with how to build a greater sense of community around Wake Forest. I think many of you have seen so many different ways that our faculty have done extraordinary work in our community. We're very curious about what the community would respond to most. So how is it that we can design programs that are meaningful to you so that we can create that shared sense of value that many people have described? I love the idea here that there's no question most of us go through our life very busy, and we get home and we're really tired, and we don't have time to do those little extra things that add so much to our life. But here we have this remarkable place in the heart of a wonderful community. What could we do together? So I'd love to hear from anybody who's got some ideas. Stretch real high. We're still doing our moving exercise.
I recently became aware of a program at Winston-Salem State University where people in the community kind of adopt a student who can't really do things like go home for Thanksgiving, and you know, they don't have somebody they can call on if they get caught out at 2:00 in the morning and stuff like that. I would be interested in becoming kind of a surrogate grandparent to a student at Wake. In a similar situation, I know that the economics of those two schools are very different, but at the same time, sometimes homesick is homesick, no matter how much support you have. Yeah. International students, how does somebody like me who lives in the neighborhood get to do something like that? I don't have family here, so it would be kind of cool to adopt somebody.
We actually, as Christina said, we have started trying to find people in the community who can reach out, especially to our international students who don't often go. So map@wfu.edu, map@wfu.edu, and I'll put you in touch with the right person.
Cool.
Awesome. Anybody doing that right now? Anybody who's volunteering to host students? Well, we'll have a long line later. Okay.
Is there any kind of media or publications that gives us this information as to what's actually available in the community?
You know,
it's very hard to source some of these things.
There, obviously, our website is a huge resource for this kind of information. There's a calendar down the right-hand tab. So not everybody wakes up every morning going, ooh, I really want to go to the Wake Forest website this morning. So understandably, we do put a monthly, there's a monthly publication that we put out to most of the media outlets around.
Okay.
Probably the easiest thing to do, if you could think of it, is to go online if you have the thought, I wonder what's going on at Wake. There's a extraordinary amount of things every single day that you could participate in.
The second part of that question is, are you working directly with the city on trying to install some of these programs into these community centers?
Yeah, there are some examples of that. They go across the whole spectrum. So the law school has a lot of activities that are coordinated with the city, the business school as well, and of course the college. So again, lots, long list. Probably for brevity's sake now, I'd say everybody go see the web. Yeah.
I've participated in lifelong learning, and it's learning for the community. I think that's excellent, and I'd like to see more different classes available.
So that's a mission that Mr. Cooper here, you want to say something about that? That's a mission that Mr. Cooper's on to try and expand that.
Well, I will pass your comment along, but the College Board, one of the things that people are very interested in is keeping in touch, not just face-to-face class, but also more opportunity to online. So there is going to be a History of Wake Forest class coming up online in the future. I expect it's going to be like, it may just blow the server when they get all the people who want to take that class.
I'm sorry, I don't want to keep you from the cookies any longer. And also, we need to get started on the next session on time, and it's supposed to start at 2:45. So if you have other questions for the speakers, please feel free to come up.
And can I just say one thing? Yeah. Just since you were just on that very subject, linking, I'm an adjunct teacher at the School of the Arts. There should be some link with the School of the Arts on this, exactly, the creative genius of this community.